born by the river in a little tent. Oh, and just like the river, I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come.
Hello, my name is Jeffrey Fletcher, and I am the owner, collector of the African American Collection. I will bring these exhibits that you see to my right and to my left into real life for individuals to take a look at every week. The inspiration, the motivation behind this collection stems from my parents who migrated from South and North Carolina respectively during the Jim Crow period. And they all have a unique story, but the collection itself and my motivation stem from both my mom and dad, as I said, hail from South and North Carolina during Jim Crow. And the interesting part about this collection that my mom was bringing together was that it told her story. It told her life growing up in rural South during Jim Crow. So as I present this collection in a series of different segments and shows here at H.A. Hartford Access Public Television, you're going to find that they open up the dialogue, the conversation that has been much anticipated as we move forward. The interesting thing about this collection is that it's very difficult to look at. The information is very hard to receive. And when you look at this collection, the first thing you're going to look at is information that stems from the 1800s slavery to the turbulent 1960s civil rights movement. And as I said, these items, these artifacts that I have collected over the years, they reflect the history of African Americans when they came on shore from the continent of Africa all the way moving forward to the 1960s. This history is very, very rich history. It's not a history that we can continue to forget. This history now is playing a part of what we see unfold across the country. So the conversation, again, we have to have this dialogue. We have to open up the channels of communication. As you see these horrific things that are over my shoulder, including the Ku Klux Klan hood and robe, that has an interesting story. The story that we will be telling is not a story that is going to make people feel as though they're having their finger pointed at them, or they're accused, or they're being accused. The story that we will be bringing is how important this history is for young people to understand where they came from. I always have a saying that I use when I do presentations, which is, in order to understand the future, we have to understand the past. And the past is now in front of us. And the longer that we continue to not want to discuss this past and this history, the longer we will have issues that will be ongoing in our generations and generations to come. What I want to bring to light here is today is that the information that you will be hearing, as I said, is sometimes troublesome. We don't know how to start it. We don't know how to understand this information. And this information is a valuable part of where we are today. But I want to go back to the collection. The collection itself, as I've been going to different schools, different universities, and public venues, the information that I present, which would be the slave manifest that I have here, the Ku Klux Klan hood and robe that I have, the Tuskegee Airmen pictures that I have, as well as the porter, the Pullman porter uniform. All of these items are important to telling this story. If we can't tell this story correctly, then there's no sense in us trying to move forward. I'd like to be able to talk a little bit about this, the motivation behind this, as I mentioned briefly. As I said, both parents, mom and dad, migrated from the South, North Carolina and South Carolina, respectively. This history is the history of what my mom had lived, and the items that you see over my shoulder to my right and my left are the information in the history that she lived growing up in the South during Jim Crow. And I did not understand this collection when I was growing up. And my roots are in Colchester, Connecticut. I was born and raised there. So living in rural Colchester, Connecticut, we didn't quite understand what our history or our roots were. But from time to time, my mom and dad would take us down south and to let us see how they grew up. And I didn't know until several years ago that this collection came about when my mom passed away. When my mom collected her collection that you see, these are some of the pieces that are over my shoulder that she collected. My mom passed away some years ago, and prior to her passing, when I went home to my town in Colchester, Connecticut, where I'm from, I would go into our house and I would see these sort of brickbats, items of Aunt Jemima cookie jars, Uncle Ben type of items laying around. And she had a special room in her home. And in this room, she had these items. And these items were, to me, they were brickbats. And there were things that were left at tag sales or estate sales, but she always had an urge to tell me that they were valuable, they were important, they were worth a lot of money. So when I looked at these items, I would say to myself, and I'd say to her, this is junk. This is really pure junk. And she would look at me and she would frown and she would say, well, I love my junk. And then I would look at my dad, who was kind of a passive guy, and he used to be the guy that would drive her from place to place and to these tag sales and to these little roadside sales, and he'd laugh. But my mother would continue to say, this stuff will be valuable someday, and you'll understand what I'm talking about. So as I'm seeing these images, if we all can go back to the 1970s, and there used to be a show called Sanford and Son. And on this show, Fred Sanford, who was an African-American junk man that lived in Watts, and he had a son by the name of Lamont, would be his partner in this junk business. So I would say to her, I'd say, Mom, you remind me of Fred Sanford. And she would look at me, she knew who he was, and she would say, well, this is my junk. I like my junk. If you don't like it, you can leave. Well, I still didn't understand why she was collecting this. And so, unfortunately, she passed away. And when she passed away, she had left containers, big Rubbermaid containers full of that junk that I soon learned was all I inherited. I have a brother and two sisters. They didn't inherit any of it, but it came to me. And I think it was kind of like her way of saying to me that, okay, this is my junk. You're going to be inheriting it. This is what you're going to take. So when I went home to my childhood residence to pick this these containers up, because it had more than just the remnants that my mom picked up from these tag sales. It had our college degrees. It had our high school degrees. It had our mortar boards, our gowns, our trophies, and everything. So here I am lifting all these big Rubbermaid crates to my mom, to my car. And I put them in my car, and I get home, set them in my basement, and when I set them in my basement, I just left them for weeks until I had time to get them. So I went down one day, had nothing else to do, and I opened up the bins, knowing that this junk would be there. But I decided to just take these things out of the bins and just stretch them out in my basement and it covered my whole entire basement, her junk. And I'm looking at it, as I'm looking down at everything, and I'm looking around, and I'm looking over, and I'm saying, I don't know what I'm going to do with this. And so as I sat down, all of a sudden I had an epiphany. And something came over me, and as I'm looking closer, that junk now starts to tell me a message. I don't know, call it divine interventions, spirituality, but all of a sudden it came across to me as I'm looking at all of these brickbats, all these pieces that were strewn across my basement floor that my mom had collected. Now it hit me. And as I said earlier, I spoke about my mom and dad's childhood roots coming from South and North Carolina. Camden, South Carolina, where my mom, and Fuqua, Farina, North Carolina, for my dad. So as I'm looking at this information, I'm now looking at history. I'm looking at a story being told by my mom, a story being told in imagery, but imagery that was hard to look at, but I took as a joke. Imagery that we look at and we don't take it serious. But I decided to take it serious. And I said, how am I going to keep this story going? How am I going to keep my mom's legacy going? And as I'm looking, I'm saying to myself, I need to get this message out. I need to get my mom's message out. How do I do this? How do I tell this story that is going to benefit not only African Americans, but all cultures of America, that there was a problem that we had in these United States. But the reality of it was my mom and my dad lived it. So that's the motivation behind my doing this African American collection. Oh, but don't think for a moment that this conversation or these artifacts were openly accepted, openly taken in. Because the road that I have come with these items and these artifacts has been and continues to be a very difficult road. So just imagine my mom living through Jim Crow, being told where she can sit, where she can go to the bathroom, being denied education. And so now what I have collected and amassed are thousands of pieces of artifacts that I have done, have collected through estate sales, tag sales, online sales, bartering. And here's the interesting part of all this. There are people that have called me, sent me emails telling me that they have items that they would like for me to take a look at. Now, mind you, I am not a history professor. I am not an anthropologist. I don't claim to be any of that. But I do claim to be somebody who is interested in this history, my history, your history, and the history that's going to make this country better than it was. So the interesting thing here is that when I start to take this collection and bring it about, I have to now be able to have that discussion with people. And sometimes I find that I have to tone the discussion down in order to bring the discussion or bring these artifacts into any institution. For instance, I won't name the institution. It's an educational institution. When I came to that institution, I sat down and I said with the powers that were there, I said, listen, I have something that will engage students. I have something that will talk about diversity. I have something that will talk about tolerance. And I have something that will actually educate and bring people up close and personal to history. The information that I bring forward, in terms of the artifacts and some of the things that I have collected to enhance my mom's collection, are slavery items. And when I started to bring this information to the individuals that were sitting in front of me at this institution, and I started telling them a little bit more about what I have, all of a sudden, they looked at each other, they shook their head at each other, and then all of a sudden, I got this conversation of, well, it might be a little too tough to look at. It might be a little hard for students to take to absorb. And at that point, I said, in defense of what I was trying to put across, because I had watered it down so much, now I have to come back and defend it. And I said, this is history. This is the DNA, or the fingerprints, or the blueprint of what America is about. So I then had to tell the truth. I'm kind of a realist in this sense, and I think sometimes it may end up biting me, but I have to tell the truth. And this collection here, it tells the truth. So when I say to them, this has the DNA, this is the blueprint of what America is about, and then I start to talk about that this history, these artifacts, have been in every state of the United States at some point in time. From the 1800s moving forward, it was practice, discrimination, racism. These things I did not make up. I didn't pull out of the sky. They were here. They were practiced. And so when I say that, I'm not saying it to say I want to come here and stir the pot or to start trouble. But what I'm trying to say is that this is our history. So you can't sweep this under the rug. It's my belief that the problem we are having and seeing today is because we want to dance around, we want to politicize, we want to make sure things are politically correct. But now here we are. Here I am, bringing this information forward, bringing this history forward. So as I'm telling these educated scholars or academia people, this is what this is about, the more I'm telling them, the more defensive I see them getting. And finally, it gets to the point where I'm told, perhaps we'll think about it. Perhaps we'll look at this another day. And to me, that was my cue, we're not interested. To me, that was my cue that we're not ready. But when are we ready to really deal with the truth of what this information's about? When do we do that? So this has not been an easy topic, and I get that. This is not an easy topic for people to have. This is not an easy discussion. You just don't walk up to somebody and say, so tell me what do you think about race relations today? It doesn't happen that way. There has to be some sort of leverage, there has to be some sort of momentum moving into that. And my feeling is the best that we can do is to start looking at the imagery that I have around me, the imagery that my mom has collected, that I have taken on in my powers to enhance. So where we are today is basically trying to piece together the past, and this is our past. And again, as I said earlier, and you're going to hear me say this through other shows, in order to understand our future, we have to understand our past. And if we don't understand our past, then there is no moving forward here. The biggest issue that I have right now is people to understand, people to know that this is not race baiting. I'm not here to race bait. I am not here to agitate. And I'm not here to do anything else except to bring a history forward, a history that has been documented, and a history that we all have ancestors that lived. One of the issues that I think is happening here, especially as I talk now, is that the country is divided. I get that. You get it. And the biggest question is, how do we bridge the gap? How do we keep from going down that path? How do we keep from keeping people like myself silent? You can't. It's just not going to happen. So again, like I said, this imagery is hard, but we have to start embracing it and saying this is what happened, and this is what we need to talk about. I've been to the Smithsonian National African American Historical Museum one time already, and as I'm walking through that museum, which is, I have to say, everybody needs to get there, it's important. It's important because we see here, we can look at this history up close and personal. And I guess that's the reason why I am bringing this history, is because it gives students, it gives adults, it affords people who cannot get to the African American Historical Museum an opportunity to see these pieces that I collect. Okay, one of the pieces that I personally am embracing and I talk about because it's pretty close to what it was that I did for a career. I'm a retired police officer, 20-year retired police officer, and one of the items that I pick up and talk about in this collection is police reform. And the police reform piece is, and the reason why you see this outfit, it has nothing to do with the imagery of saying police officers are Klansmen. That's not why this imagery is here, because the imagery here is when people of color, African Americans, are involved or engaged in any type of negative misconduct with police officers, the first thing that comes out is the badge beneath the robe, or the police officer being a Klan. Now, I loved my profession. I took my profession seriously, and that is not the case. That is not the case where the police officers are the Klan. There is a very, very minute segment, just like across the society, where there are individuals who are bad apples or bad actors, a very small percentage. So what I try to do when we're talking about police reform as well, I bring this up, and I bring this up to police departments, because this is the image that I try to dispel. This is the image that I bring forward to police departments, that I say, look, this is how society sees us. And notice I say us, because I wore that uniform, I wore it proudly, and I tried to be as fair as I could be. But there's a minute, as I said before, there's a minute segment of people in our society that wear that blue uniform that don't honor it. So therefore, this imagery will come up in my collection, will come up in my conversation sometimes, and I make sure that I clarify that I am not trying to tarnish the uniform. I am not trying to make the uniform look bad. I am trying to give officers, give the law enforcement culture an opportunity to take a look at how they are perceived. And again, as I said earlier, I'm a realist. I tell it like it is. There is no black or white. There is no right or wrong. And I'm fair across the board. Now, I'll move away from my good friend the Klansman here with the uniform, and we'll talk about another imagery that we talk, something positive, because people say, well, you know, you're showing all this negative, you're showing shackles, which, by the way, you'll see in the collection as we move forward with other shows, shackles. You'll see things of bondage that people were held in. And that was that's the other piece that I get. Why are you showing all this negativity? Why are you showing all this bad information? Why can't we see things like pictures of Jackie Robinson, Muhammad Ali, Venus and Serena Williams, Magic Johnson, and most of your Beyonce and Jay-Z? Well, those are the good things. And people don't realize that they didn't get to where they got because they were naturally that talented. There were people that paved the way for them. There were people that made it for them to be where they are. So when we talk about the negative things of this collection, it's a reality. It's a truism. But we can move on and we could talk about things like the Tuskegee Airmen. Those were pioneers. Those were heroes. And in this collection, you'll see items, pictures, even artifacts that relate to the Tuskegee Airmen. So we do show artifacts that are positive. It's not always negative, but we have to balance the scale here. You just can't show all of the good things that African Americans contributed to the United States. We have to show the bad things that happened to them, that motivated them to be the Jackie Robinsons, the Magic Johnsons, the Beyoncés. And I might be dating myself by keep calling Magic Johnson because I'm of that era. So we'll talk about the Pullman Porter, how important the Pullman Porter was, and what role the Pullman Porter played. And again, this is a part of our history. And again, these are our DNA. These are our fingerprints. This is what and where we are. So I jump around from space to pace, from item to item, just to let you see that there is a cross-culture, reference of different time periods within our history. What I want to bring up now is the fact that we are moving towards trying to figure the conversation, how we need to do the conversation. And I'm going to keep talking about that because we don't talk enough about it. And again, we have to be honest with ourselves. And you know, one of the things I promised my assistant on the way here that I was not going to bring this conversation up, but I feel remiss if I didn't. So with what we're seeing in the landscape today of the Charlottesville, Virginia situation, and we're talking about, because right, the whole thing is about having the conversation, opening up the dialogue, as well as to talk about imagery. Now, the statutes are imagery, correct? They are. Robert E. Lee statues are imagery. They are historical items which represent history. And a history that those statues represent come a negative history, a negative past. So when you talk about imagery, you got to ask yourself, is it okay to show, to champion, to praise a statue that is shown publicly around the country, or for that matter, along the Northeast and in the Southeast, in the South, a statue that represented an individual who was all for fighting to keep slavery? Or would you like to talk about a history that has negative imagery of people being bound, people being sold, just like cattle, just as cattle and other livestock? So when I talk about Charleston, Virginia, and I talk about that statue or statues coming down, one of the things I say to people, and I said to my assistant, is that the imagery around me, the artifacts around me, they look like bad things, but they didn't do anything to anyone. The imagery and the statues that we're talking about that's controversial, that need to come down, are bad things or represent bad things. And so when we think about the institutions, the Robert E. Lee Street, Robert E. Lee School, Robert E. Lee in our town halls or our public, our judicial systems, you got to ask yourself, is this the imagery that we want to portray? This is the imagery that we want to continue to say is positive for our young kids? Because think about it. If you talk to your children about what Robert E. Lee represented, what are you going to say? He was a good man. He was a man that represented everything that our United States, our Constitution, our ideals are about? No. So when you think about those statues, there's no real significance in that statue of being good to me. And that's my commentary on that. But when you look at the articles here, they represent something. They represent people worked hard, people bled, they sweat, they cried, And this is the result of what I have to do, is to bring these things out. So Charlottesville, Virginia was a very hard, very difficult time. It was unfortunate that a life was lost. I'm here to hopefully believe that what I'm trying to do is to bring some good, to bring some information, to bring some history, to bring some ideas, to come to the table so that we can have that conversation. Now, no longer sweep this under the rug. And this message, it goes out not only to whites, it goes out to African Americans as well, because we kind of perpetuate this whole process of this information, this artifact. I've run into African Americans who said, this is hard. This is hard stuff to talk about. We don't want to see that anymore. We lived that before. When do we stop and say, this is our history, as painful as it may be? We can no longer allow our history to be buried as it has been. And those are some of the things that I'll be talking about as we move on to other segments of the show. Is talk about why do we feed into the perpetual cycle of keeping this history hidden. It's not a great history, but it's a good history for everybody to know because it has some positives to it. Lastly, I want to talk about the engagement of outside guests. This show, we're hoping to have enlightened conversations from law enforcement to political to local individuals on weekly basis, if we can do that, and if I can get individuals to engage in the conversations about what's going on locally and nationally, I think that would be very productive. That would be very enlightening, and it would be an educational piece that I think we all would walk away from. So on that note, I'd like to close out by saying I want to thank Hartford Public Access Television, Mr. Gil Martinez, for sitting with me, being patient enough to understand and trying to figure out where we need to go and how we need to figure out how to engage in the conversation of trying to make people's lives better. We will be back next week, and we'll have a more informative and lively conversation. Thank you.
I was born. In a little tent, oh, and just like the river, I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I